I grew up in the times of the Game Boy, the Super Nintendo, and the N64. When recently traveling to Japan, I felt quite some retro vibes and just had to purchase a Super Nintendo Classic Mini when back home. Transparent consoles and gamepads were the hip thing back in the 90s, and I wanted to make my new Classic Mini unique. So I 3D scanned the housing and 3D printed replicas in resin. Let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. I can remember that even since I was a small boy, I always wanted one of these Game Boys that had the transparent housing. Since I was very interested in electronics and technology, it was so great being able to take a look at the guts of one of those devices. Well, I never got one. That's probably why I ended up as a mechanical engineer and not an electrical engineer. Anyways, during my recent holiday in Japan, we visited Super Potato, a retro gaming store in Tokyo. Three stories full of Super Famicom, Sega Genesis, and everything else desirable. After playing a couple of arcades and seeing all of those consoles of my childhood, I had to directly purchase a Super Nintendo Classic Mini to play some old classics back home. The only thing missing was a cool gamepad to really take me back to when I was a small boy. Since I still had the GOM Atos Core, a professional 3D scanner at my disposal, I thought it might be a great and interesting project to 3D scan the injection molded housing of a gamepad and then print them out of clear resin on a 3D printer. The GOM Atos Core that GOM kindly provided for a couple of weeks for my research and videos is a structured light scanner that consists out of a projector and two cameras. It projects a line pattern on the object that you are scanning and then calculates the shape of the part by evaluating how the pattern is deflected. The cool thing about such a professional machine is that it's calibrated and therefore the scans are really perfectly to size. You scan a part in several steps because each scan only captures a part of the object that is visible at that point. Eventually, you take shots from several perspectives and match them together using reference point stickers. Even though the injection molds I wanted to scan didn't look particularly complex, they were a bit challenging to scan because you need a lot of different shots to capture the whole part. I could have put a ton of reference points on the parts and scanned them that way, but that seemed kind of wasteful and, more importantly, at the locations of the stickers, the geometry is slightly altered. In order to perform such a task, experts use a reference frame around such objects that are held in the structures by studs. This way, the part doesn't need to be marked and all shots can be referenced with the surrounding frame. I didn't have one of those, so I made one myself. I bought 15x15mm aluminum profiles in the hardware store and cut pieces on a miter saw to get a rectangle a bit bigger than the part I wanted to scan. The part will later be held in place by M4 threaded rod, so for simplicity, I already drilled the holes and cut threads in the pieces. Probably 10 years ago I bought a bag of aluminum solder or brazing rod that I finally wanted to try out to put the pieces together to form a whole frame. TIG welding would have been the better option, but unfortunately, I don't own a welder. Using the brazing rod requires a bit of preparation. Basically, most aluminum that you can buy here in the hardware store is anodized, and that will ruin your day while brazing. This is why I used the file to reveal the bare metal at all of the locations. Brazing itself is not too hard and is in a way similar to soldering copper wire. The issue with aluminum brazing is that you need to keep the parts hot during that process so that the material can flow where it needs to. This is why many struggle brazing bigger parts. Aluminum is unfortunately a good conductor of heat, so the heat of your torch will be gone in no time. I tackled that by kind of floating the part on just a couple of studs. This doesn't reduce heat conduction, but will prevent that heat sinks into the working surface that I used. I clamped everything in place, heated the joint, and rubbed the brazing rod on the corner from time to time until the melting temperature of the rod was reached, which is, by the way, a good bit lower than the melting point of aluminum. This was then repeated for all of the corners until I got a very nice and very sturdy frame. I painted it in matte black, so it's less likely to be picked up during the scanning process. I then added a bunch of reference points for scan alignment, because you need at least 3 points visible in each scan that the alignment process works. Finally, I mounted the gamepad housing using the threaded rods, of which I sharpened the tips a little to not block too much scan area. I screwed the rods until they touched the part and increased the stiffness by tightening a counter nut. The part is then held in position via a drop of super glue, because it needs to be properly secured in place, and you can't clamp the part because that will deform its shape and therefore make the scan useless. I scanned the parts from many different angles, from the top and the bottom. The reference frame ensured that the software was able to match all of them in one complete part. The scan itself only gives you a point cloud that, at first, even still contains parts of the reference frame and the threaded rods, but they can be selected and removed. After that step, the point cloud is converted to a surface mesh, so basically the final STL. Unfortunately, there were areas I wasn't able to reach during scanning, due to the tight spaces, and also at the locations of the fixtures, there were still holes in the model. For the 3D printing process, the mesh needs to be closed and watertight. This is done by a simple hole closing tool that locates the voids and then closes them with additional surfaces, taking the curvature of the surrounding into consideration. And there we have it, two beautiful 3D scans of the Super NES classic mini gamepad shells. I was really impressed by the amount of details I was able to get from the 3D scans. Really beautiful. If you like this video, then please consider subscribing and click the bell to not miss any upcoming videos. These models could now be printed out, but as I said before, there were some spots that I couldn't reach, but that are functionally important. So the through holes that hold the shells together are mostly closed, and also the slots for the shoulder buttons are not perfect. For this reason, I went into Fusion 360, loaded the scanned data, and just created simple shapes at the locations where I want to remove material. Unfortunately, you can't perform Boolean operations on mesh in Fusion, so that's why I exported the bodies that need to be removed as additional STLs and imported them into Microsoft's 3D Builder, in which you can subtract two bodies from each other very easily. So now the only thing that is still left is to export the edited mesh, and we are ready to print. Similar to FDM 3D prints, resin prints also need to be supported during the printing process. I used Prusa Slicer 2.1 for support generation, in which I loaded the part and rotated it in a way that it fit the build volume. The automatic supports already helped to find the most critical locations, but a couple of test prints showed me that there were specific areas in which I had to place even a bit more than suggested. The fully supported model is then exported once again and sent to the resin printer using their proprietary software. The resin printer that I used is the DAS 3D L120, which is a so-called MSLA or masked SLA printer. Just for clarification, I don't really recommend it due to its horrible software. If you want a resin printer, maybe buy something different. I just don't have anything else. The machine basically consists out of a UV LED, an LCD screen, a resin vat, and a movable build platform. The model that we print is sliced into 50 micrometer thick layers, which results in a stack of images that are white in the regions where material will be, and black everywhere else. The printer now loads these images in successive order and puts them on the screen, allowing the UV light only to pass in the white areas, where the resin then cures. The particular resin that I used was Anycubic's clear resin that was very pleasant to use with only minimal odor. The build platform is lifted and lowered after each layer, so that new resin can flow into the curing area. After 10 hours and more than 1000 layers, the print was finished and really looked stunning. After removing it from the platform and washing it thoroughly in rubbing alcohol, it's fully cured using UV light or just the sun, if available. Removing the supports is very easy and it feels kind of similar to a Velcro strip. The supports on these parts are a bit wasteful and make up 50% of the final resin consumption, but I didn't find a better solution. Unfortunately, the parts lost a bit of their transparency during the cleaning process because they still have a bit of micro roughness. Looking at the part under a microscope shows the individual pixels of the screen forming the voxels of the part. Looks kind of like a miniature Minecraft landscape. To restore some of the transparency, I coated the part in a couple of layers of clear coat, which smooths out the surfaces and gives a really nice look. And there we have it! The only thing still necessary is installing the electronics and putting it back together. I was really impressed how well both printed halves fit together. Only the upper and lower sides are a bit deformed from the printing process, but that isn't that bad. Out of curiosity, I also 3D scanned one of the printed test parts and checked it for accuracy, and it was impressive to see how well the whole copying process worked out. Alright, that's it! Let me know in the comments what you think of this project and if you also have fond memories of your childhood consoles.
Thank you for watching! I hope you enjoyed this little project I made. If so, then don't forget to leave a like, subscribe to the channel and hit the bell. If you want to help me make these videos, then please consider becoming a patron or help me out in other ways. Also take a look at the other videos available on my channel, I'm sure you'll like them. I hope to have you around in the next one. Auf Wiedersehen and goodbye!